Good evening, guys. It's Pastor Chris at True Life Way. Hope you've had a great day. Hope you've had a great weekend. Today, I have a very encouraging and inspirational message for you that is important that we understand that when storms and trials and situations and sin and temptation and falling into temptation, when it comes, that we're still going to praise God and through it all. Amen. That no matter what happens, we're still going to praise God. Amen. But I got a song I want to sing for you this morning that sometimes the devil comes in. He likes to take our joy. He likes to steal our joy from us. And it's time that we go to the enemy camp and take back what he took from us in the first place. Amen.
I went to the enemy's camp. And I took back what he stole from me. I took back what he stole from me. I took back what he stole from me. Well, I went to the enemy's camp. And I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Well, he's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. I took back what he stole from me. I took back what he stole from me. Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Well, he's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. Took back what he stole from me. I took back what he stole from me. Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. Satan
is under your feet.
But he's under my feet.
Amen, amen. You see, sometimes when Satan comes in and he tries to take all our joy, he tries to take all the stuff that God's given us. He tries to trick you into thinking that you're a nobody, that you're nothing, that you're not worthy of anything. He tries to plant that in your mind that you don't need to worship God anymore because I've taken the joy. I've done all this stuff. You don't have to keep praising him. Amen. That's the mindset the devil wants you to get. Somebody say amen. Amen. That's the mindset the devil wants you to get. That after he's coming and taking everything, that you don't have to praise the Lord anymore. He's like, what's the point in praising God? I've already taken everything from you. Amen. And some of us fall victim to that all the time. But as I said, I have a very inspirational message that I want to preach to you tonight. And the title of the sermon is simply called, Still Gonna Praise You. Still Gonna Praise You. We have to get to the point that we are going to trust God no matter what. That no matter what may come our way, we are going to trust God and continue to praise God. Amen. If you have your Bibles and want to follow along, you can turn to Psalms 34:1 for our first scripture reading. It is a scripture we've all heard before. But Psalms 34:1 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. If you bow your heads, we're going to pray. Lord, we thank you for this night you give us, God. We thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. I ask that you let this message be a seed planted in someone's life today, God, that it may grow and nurture in them, Lord, and that you will touch them, Lord, and you will use them for your glory, God. And I ask that you will also be with a friend of mine who recently lost his wife to cancer. I ask that you will touch him and his family, Lord. I ask that you will be with him today and his family and strengthen them during this difficult time, God, and anybody else that may be stricken with cancer, Lord. You know the need and you know the situation, Lord. We ask that you will touch them in accordance to your will and your purpose, and we love you, and we give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, praying. Church, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We all go through things in life, storms, trials, situations, some worse than others. You know, have you ever gone through a storm that may not have been as bad as the previous storm? How about in life, in real life, when you go outside and there's stormy weather coming in? Have you ever seen a storm that was worse than others? Well, that's how it happens in life with us with us too. Some storms aren't as bad as the other ones. But what it is that we do during those storms, what is it that we do when we come through, when we come to these storms? What is it that we do? Do we turn and hide? Do we face what we got to face? Or do we turn and run the other way? Do we just stop believing in our God and give up? Or do we praise God even more? You know that song, Praise You in the Storm, or Casting Crowns? I thought about doing that one, but this new setup, I don't have that track right here. We know that things are easier on the mountaintop. When you're on top of the mountain, it's easy. You know, we even had that thing that, you know, valleys will teach us stuff mountaintops never can. It's easier to be on the mountaintop, but the same God we serve on the mountaintop is the same God in the valley. Amen? It's the same God. He is the same God. So I declare today that no matter how grim things may look, no matter sickness, no matter the sickness that may come my way, I'm still going to praise you, Lord. That's the mindset I want today. You know, there was a moment in King David's life where it seemed like worshiping God would have been the last thing on his mind. And perhaps maybe if he had been praying, if he had been worshiping, he wouldn't have fallen into the temptation and sinned. And this particular moment in David's life is something a lot of us could relate to in the world we live in today. Long story short, David sinned and he worshiped the Lord anyways. I've talked to a lot of people that say that the things I've done in my life, the things I've done in my past, there's no way that God would ever love me. There's no way God would ever accept me. So what's the point? What is the point in me crying out to the Lord? What is the point in me trying to worship the Lord with all the things I've done wrong in my life? Amen. I'm sure everybody's knows somebody that has said something similar to that. Amen. They say, what's the point? But I'll tell you, there is a reason that we should continue to worship the Lord no matter what we have done or what the storm or trial may be that we're going through. Just as King David did. Amen? Just as King David did. David was walking along the rooftop of his palace. And the Bible says he sees a very beautiful woman down below bathing. He sees her down there bathing. He inquires, who is she? And he finds out that she is Bathsheba, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. And he sends for her. And eventually has her at his place. And she winds up pregnant. Not going into big details here because I've got small ears in the room. As king, he commands that her husband is sent from the front lines to the front lines where the battle was the most fierce. Where the soldiers on the opposite team are the biggest. Where they're the strongest. So he is more likely to be killed after, you know, to hide his affair with Bathsheba. And he dies, and he takes Bathsheba to be his wife. And David's actions, the Bible says, that did not make the Lord happy. The Lord was displeased in King David's actions. Nathan the prophet is sent to David, who served as a counselor to King David, to tell him, you know what, man? You messed up. I mean, have you ever had people in your life that come to you, and you just know it was the Lord that sent them? Like, you know what? You messed up. Amen. He says, you messed up, David. He tells David about a rich and poor man in a certain city, and that the rich man, he had all kinds of cattle, lots of cattle. And the poor man, he only had but one lamb. That's all he had in his life was one lamb. And a traveler comes to the rich man. But the rich man didn't want to kill one of his own to serve him. So he takes the lamb that the poor man had to prepare it. And then when David hears this, he's angry. He said, and what he hears and says, that rich man shall surely die. He should be put to death and the restore the lamb fourfold. And Nathan doesn't beat around the bush. He tells him, you're that man. You're that man. You took Bathsheba, had a child, orchestrated the death of Uriah, her husband, trying to hide your sin. Now we're going to jump to 2 Samuel 12, 13 through 16. I'll give you a few moments to get there if you're following along in your Bible. And starting at verse 13, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. And Nathan departed unto his house, and the Lord struck that child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth. So David's told that he isn't going to be put to death, but because of his sin, the child that was born through this affair, the child is not going to survive. The child is going to die. Nathan leaves, and David begins to pray to God that his child doesn't die. Like, who else? I mean, who wouldn't? To get that kind of news, hey, Chris, because of your sin, your son's going to die. You're going to be hitting your knees. You're going to be praying. You're going to be fasting. You're going to do anything you can. Amen? And that's exactly what David did. He fasted and laid there, refusing to eat or do anything. He didn't want his child to die. Pick back up at verse 18. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he then vex himself if we tell him that the child is dead? But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore David said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is dead. Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel and came into the house of the Lord and worshipped. Then he came to his own house, and when he required, they set bread before him, and he did eat. Then saith his servants unto him, what thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst fast and weep for the child while it was alive, but when the child was dead, thou didst rise and eat bread. And he said, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept. For I said, who can tell whether God will be gracious to me that the child may live? But now he's dead. Wherefore should I fast? Can I bring him back again? Shall I go to him? But he shall not return to me. So on the seventh day, his son, he did end up dying. And the Bible tells us that the servants were afraid to tell David. And he could see his servants. I can picture that he come out of the room and maybe saw his servants standing in the hallway like just whispering to one another. And he could already tell that something was not right, that something had gone wrong. And he knew that his son had died, and he just asked plainly, is the child dead? And they said, he is dead. They confirmed that he is dead. So he gets up and he washes himself, anoints himself, and he goes and changes his clothes. And he went to the house of the Lord. And what did he do? He didn't go to the house of the Lord to start crying. He didn't go to the house of the Lord to mourn, weep. He goes and starts worshiping the Lord. His son just died, and he's going to worship the Lord. Amen? Does that sound crazy? Mm-hmm. He's going out to worship the Lord after his son died. Amen. That's what he did. That's exactly what he did. And when he went home, he wanted food. They brought him food and he ate. But the servants were perplexed at this. They said, you know what? What are you doing? You fasted and cried for your son while he's alive, but now that he's dead, now you get up and you eat. What's wrong? What's up with that? And he tells him, while the child was alive, I cried and prayed. Excuse me. I fasted for my son's life. Who can tell if God will show some grace and allow my child to live? He's dead now. Why should I fast for him now? I can't bring him back. I go to him, but he can never return, come back to me. And this is a great example. And I want y'all to listen to this. It's a great example of how life is with, how it is with us sometimes, and how it can be. David, even after committing sin with Bathsheba, having her husband Uriah killed so he could hide the sin, having his son die, he still went and worshiped the Lord. After all of this, he still went and worshiped the Lord. You know, if you allow any kind of sin that you've done in your life, present, past, whatever it may be, if you allow that to determine your worship, you're never going to get anywhere. You will be a lost cause. You can't let that determine your worship. You can't keep that from, you can't let that keep you from praising God. Amen? We have to have that mindset that no matter what happens, we are going to praise the Lord. Amen. We are going to praise the Lord. David's son was conceived in sin, but he was still David's son. And, you know, and didn't want his child to die. I mean, like any other person, like I said, you wouldn't want your child to die. But even after the death of his son, he went and worshiped the Lord. We have to get there in our life. We have to get to that point. We have to get to that mindset that no matter what happens, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm still going to praise you. Amen. When we lose our job, I'm still going to praise you. When we receive that diagnosis, we are still going to praise you. When our loved ones die, we are still going to praise you. When the storms are closing in, no matter how big or small, we are going to praise you. It doesn't matter what comes our way. Doesn't matter how it may look. I'm still going to praise you. That's what it's about. I'm going to trust my God through the storm. I'm going to trust Him to get me through. No matter how much my sin may be, no matter what I've done in my past, no matter what I do in the future or the present, I'm going to praise you. Amen? Mm-hmm. I'm going to praise my way through the battle. I'm going to praise my way through the storm. I'm going to praise my way through the circumstance, the trial, the situation. I'm going to praise you through all of it. Through it all. Amen? Mm-hmm. But it is so easy to give up when we receive the bad news. It's so easy when you get that diagnosis. You've got cancer. It's so easy just to throw in the towel and say, I quit. Lord, I've been a faithful servant for all this time, and now all of a sudden I've got cancer. I'm going to praise you, Lord, through the diagnosis. It's so easy to quit fighting a seemingly losing battle. Because that devil likes to come in and says, ha, you've got cancer. If the Lord really loved you, he would have let you get cancer. He likes to plant that junk in your mind. But I tell you right now, don't listen to the devil, because he's a liar. Amen? Whew. He's a liar. But we must keep going. We must keep praising him in the storm. We should declare right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ that no matter what comes my way, I'm going to praise Him. I'm still going to praise Him. And I don't mean just say it, I mean declare it. And not only declare it, but believe it. That's what I'm going to do. That I'm going to keep praising Him. I'm still going to praise you, Lord. No matter what, I'm still going to praise Him. Amen? Mm-hmm. One more scripture to read and we're going to get off here. Psalms 156. That is 150, verse 6. Amen. Let everything that hath breath, what? Praise ye the Lord. Amen. Let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. And that first verse. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. What are we supposed to do? We're supposed to praise the Lord at all times. In times of triumph. In times of defeat. In all the times in between. We are to praise the Lord. And no matter what, I don't care how dark the clouds may get. I don't care how bad the lightning may be. I don't care how bright the lightning may flash. I am going to trust you, Lord. Amen. It doesn't matter how bad it gets. I don't care if the trees look like they're about to snap. I'm going to keep praising you, Lord, in the storm. Amen. Lord, we love you tonight, God. We thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. God, I ask that if there's anybody under the sound of my voice at this, anybody under the sound of my voice at this time, God, that no matter what they may be going through, no matter what they may be facing, Lord, if it's cancer or diabetes or whatever it may be, Lord, that you will come in and touch their bodies right now in the name of Jesus. Because for by your stripes we are healed, and we believe you are still in the miracle business. We believe that you are still in the healing business, God, because you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You do not change. You are worthy, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, for that. But I just ask that you will be with each and everybody, Lord, that watches or listens to this sermon tonight, God, that it will touch them, Lord, in a way that they have not been touched yet, Lord, that they can realize finally that you love them and that you want them to serve you. And that no matter what they've done in their past, you are here to redeem them and save them. For only you can. And we love you tonight, God. And we give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, pray. And the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, I hope you got something out of this message tonight. But I want you to remember, no matter what happens, no matter what comes your way, no matter how bad the storm looks, no matter how bad the wind is, keep praising him. Praise him through the storm. No matter what happens, I'm still going to praise you. Amen. Well, I hope you like this message. And we love you guys. God bless you. And we will see you on the next one. Take care.